Hey there, cool cats and kittens. Welcome back to Psychology 101. Sorry, 111 with your host, Brother Wooly. I am bringing you to Chapter 3 today. Chapter 3 is spelled like this. That's how you spell Chapter 3. Now you can tell it's really easy to read, and I'm going to do my best to make that not so terrible. But you don't need to write that down. Chapter 3 is on sensation and perception. So we have the idea that the nervous system is what helps us to bring in information, and we know that sensory cells are what allow us to grab that information from the outside world. So we're going to get to the specifics of that sensory information coming in. And then the second half, we're going to talk about the perception or the understanding of what that stuff is. So let's write down our list of terms before we get going. So the first thing we have is sensation and perception. Sensation is just the simple awareness of a stimulus. Knowing that something is happening. Knowing that light is on, or sound is there, or that touch has happened. It's the simple awareness only. So write that down. Simple awareness. Perception is the understanding of what that sensation truly is. Or at least what we think that it is. We're going to find out in this chapter that some of our senses can be very easily tricked. Okay? So a simple awareness of a stimulus and the understanding of what the sensation is sensation and perception. Now, when scientists started looking at sensation and perception, they wanted to figure out what were the limits of sensation. What was the most and least amount that someone could sense? I better not throw that in the ground because I'm gonna need it later. So what were the lowest limits and the highest limits? Now, you can experiment with levels of sensation. But the problem is that when you go too high, people tend to get hurt. Like, you don't stand in front of a jet engine and listen to that jet engine for very long because it will damage your eardrums. So scientists can't test the upper limits, because when they do, people get hurt or possibly die. But they can experiment with the lowest limit. And there's a term for that. It's called the absolute threshold. Absolute threshold. The absolute threshold, and this is in your book, is defined as the minimum amount of sensation, the minimal amount of stimulus, the minimal amount of stimulus for an organism to register it or hear it or see it or whatever, 50% of the time. 50% is our key here. If it's loud enough that I can hear it every time, but if it's too quiet that I can't hear it at all, then it's not the absolute threshold. The absolute threshold has to be so quiet that I can only hear it about half the time. That's my lowest limit. And sight, sound, smell, taste, and touch, I think I got those all, all have their own limits. Now, here's the interesting part. Because in the 1800s, scientists actually figured out what these absolute thresholds are. And I'm not sure if they're in the book, but the standards haven't changed since then. For instance, and you don't need to know these for the test, but just here's an example of absolute thresholds. The absolute threshold for sight is one candle on a clear, dark night, 30 miles away. 30 miles away, one candle. And if you were to look at it and look for it and look for it, you would be able to sense it half of the time, so the story goes. For sound, it's the tick of a watch at, I want to say it's 10 or 20 or 15 feet. I think it's 15 feet. The tick of a watch at 15 feet. For taste, it's 1 teaspoon of sugar in 2 gallons of water. And if you were to mix that all together, or just half a teaspoon of sugar in 1 gallon of water, and then serve it to people, some of them might be able to tell that there's sugar in it, and others won't experience anything at all. Let's see. Smell is 1 drop of perfume in a 700 square foot room, which is typically about the size of an entire apartment. So it's not a whole lot of space. And then touch. I do all of them. Touch is, and this is the funniest one, dropping a fly's wing from 1 centimeter onto someone's cheek. And that would only be more funny if that was a joke. But that's how they did it. They would have someone laying on there with their eyes closed, and they would drop different insect wings on them until they could barely sense it only 50% of the time. Turns out a housefly, when you rip its wings off and drop them on your friend's cheeks at 1 centimeter height, they will only sense it 50% of the time. And you can only imagine some scientist intern in the 1800s who was trying to figure out which bugs would work best and would have to sit there at their station and just rip off insect wings and then collect them and then drop them on people's faces. So, so gross. Okay, so let's see. Sight, smell, taste, touch, and hearing. Yeah, we did them all. Okay. No, hearing I said twice. I don't know. If I didn't do all 5, you can look up the other one that I didn't say, but I think I said them all. So that's the absolute threshold. That's another one. So after we got the absolute threshold figured out, we had to figure out what was the level that was needed, an increase or decrease, how much do I need to increase or decrease a stimulus before I'm able to sense that there's been a change? For instance, if I had a 1-pound dumbbell at the gym in one hand and a 5-pound dumbbell in the other hand, the question is, can I tell the difference? And obviously, there is enough of a difference that I can tell between 1 pound and 5 pounds. But what if I had a 5-pound weight and a 5-pound 1-ounce weight? Now I only have 1 ounce of difference. Is that enough for me to sense a difference in their weights? Probably not. So science wanted to figure out what would be the increase or decrease needed in order to sense a change. And they came up with this term that's called just noticeable difference. The just noticeable difference between 2 stimuli is the amount of increase or decrease that is needed to sense that there's been a change. And when they figured this out, they would just give people stimuli, either light or sound or touch, and they would increase it by a certain percentage. And what they found is that sight had a percentage that worked really well on an increase or decrease. Touch had a difference in percentage. All of the 5 senses had their own difference in their own different scales, rather, for the just noticeable difference. But then along came a man whose last name was Weber. Weber. Oh my gosh. This is just literally a chalk paint. A chalkboard paint. Weber. I can read that. Weber came along and said, you know what, we need to standardize this. So Weber came up with the idea, or not the idea, but he came up with the result, that if it's anywhere from 3 to 5% difference, if there's a 3 to 5% difference, 3 to 5, then you should be able to tell the difference between the 2 stimuli. So if I have a weight and I make it 3 to 5% lighter or heavier, I should be able to sense the difference. So the just noticeable difference and Weber's law both have the same definition, which is the amount of increase or decrease needed to understand that a stimulus has now changed. But Weber's law made it a constant. So on an answer for the test, Both of these are synonyms, but you will never see both of them as this as an answer for a question. If you see one or the other, they're the same thing. It's just that Weber's law made it constant at 3 to 5%. Okay, so we've talked about absolute thresholds, the just noticeable difference, sensation and perception. We have a couple more before we dive into everything here. Looks like I've permanently etched Weber into the chalkboard. Fantastic. Never going to get rid of that. Let's talk about two different terms. In order for us to have sensation, our sensory cells need to be activated. So when sound waves come into the ear, and strike the eardrum, that transfers to a bunch of different things, and we'll get to that because we're actually going to talk about this process. But the sensory cells are activated, and they have a job, and their job is called transduction. Transduction means to take a physical stimulus and turn it into electrical or neural electricity, or signal rather, an electrical or neural signal so that the brain can read it. So when light goes into the back of my eye and strikes my retina, my rods and cones in the back of my eye will transduce that physical light into a neural signal that my visual cortex can understand. Same thing with hearing, same thing with touch, same thing with taste. Our brains only read one thing, and that's electricity or neural energy. And our sensory cells need to change that physical property of sound or light or taste or touch or taste or pressure or temperature into an electrical signal. And that process is called transduction. So all of our sensory cells use transduction to create the sensation to our brain. And then lastly, what happens if you go into a smelly place, like an outhouse or something, like you're camping, and you go into this smelly place and instantly it hits you and you're like, whoa, this is bad. But the longer you sit there, the less and less it seems to be, right? The more you are put on, the more constant a stimulus is, the less you react to it. And that is a term we call habituation. In a sense, it becomes a habit. Your brain starts to ignore it. So when you are subjected to a stimulus for a long time, your body stops reacting so much to it. That's habituation. Okay? So those are all of our terms before we get into our first half, which we call sensation. So let's go through the five senses. This moment is brought to you by Brother Willie's can of Mountain Dew. Brother Willie's can of Mountain Dew, making him sane for years to come. Okay, sight. Let's go with sight. The most easily tricked sense you have. Sight works like this. You have an eyeball. And you don't need to memorize all the parts, but I am going to list some of the parts here. And we're looking at it from the side here. And light travels into the eyeball through the pupil, right? And it passes through a lens. And when it hits the lens, it actually flips upside down. So everything that's over here on the outside world is projected upside down onto the back of your eyeball. Inside the eyeball is called eye juice. No, it's really called aqueous humor, but eye juice just sounds more fun. Your eye's like a water balloon filled with clear liquid. Light passes through that clear liquid and gets to the back and then creates an image on the area we call the retina. I ran out of room. Retina, R-E-T-I-N-A. The retina has all of the sensory cells on them that transduce light into a neural signal. We'll get to that in a second. right here attached by the retina is the optical nerve, and the optical nerve transmits the data to the visual cortex. The iris is the part of the eye that has the color. That's what's here on the front. And you have a cornea. The cornea is a clear area right here at the very front of the eye. Okay, so light comes in, gets flipped upside down, gets projected onto the retina, is read by the retina, and then transmitted through transduction to the visual cortex. So let's talk about what's going on in the back of the eye. Let's take a look at the retina. If this was the retina, you'll see that there are two different kinds of sensory cells. The lengths of these is just for the graphic. These aren't to scale or anything. But you have two kinds. You have rods and you have cones. Rods and cones. Rods and cones. Cones. Rods are in charge of two things: black and white and brightness. So your rods are in charge of your night vision. They adjust your sensation to the brightness of an object. They also allow you to see better at night. It takes about 30 minutes for your night vision to fully form. So if you wanted to form it in the middle of the day, you'd have to keep your eyes closed or covered for about a half an hour and then go into only a dark space. We've probably all experienced what it's like to have night vision and then have it ruined instantly by a bright light coming on into our eyes. And we almost have a sensation of pain or just something uncomfortable because the rods are sending a much bigger signal based on the tiny bit of light they're getting. And so when they get flooded and they're not ready, they go, crap, and they send way too much. And the brain kind of freaks out and we go, I'm not ready for that. Okay, so that's what the rods do. They're in charge of brightness and they're in charge of black and white. The cones, on the other hand, are in charge of color. And there's three kinds of cones. We have cones for red light, blue light, and green light. And each set of cones is activated by this spectrum of light. So when a red color comes in and hits a red cone, that sends a signal to the brain and you sense red. Same with blue, same with green. And the reason why we have three here is the name of our first of two different theories on how we see color. And the first theory is called the trichromatic theory. We'll keep those here. And this is one word. Trichromatic. Trichromatic is one word. Trichromatic. And that does not look really great, I can tell. But the trichromatic theory says we have three color theory. When I have three sets of cones, red, green, and blue, and they see any color that comes into my eye, they then send their own signals. The brain takes all the signals from red, green, and blue and says, that's purple, or brown, or black, or red, or yellow. And so the differences in these signals allow the brain to perceive different colors. And that's what the trichromatic theory is about. What do you suppose would happen if you were born without one set of cones? What if you only had red and blue and you didn't have green? Well, this is where color blindness comes into play. The reason why people are colorblind is because genetically they don't have one or more of the set of cones that they're supposed to have. And because of that, colors get mixed up in the brain. The brain has a really hard time distinguishing because it's only given part of the picture, not the whole picture. I'm not sure how they work, but the enchroma glasses that people who suffer from color blindness can put on, and then somehow that changes the signal enough that they can tell the difference between colors. If you did not have any cones at all, you would have what we call monochromatic color blindness. If you have monochromatic color blindness, that means that you can only see in one color, and that's black and white, either or gray. I mean, everything's going to be white or black. So that's what monochromatic color blindness is. Now, here's a fun fact. There are a small population of women, and you can Google this to find out more information. And it's only women because it's a double X recessive trait in our genetics. And these women have four sets of cones. And so if you want to look this one up, look up quad chromatic. Look up quad chromatic eyes. And women who have this can't really describe to you well what a color to them looks like, because they see color very differently than most of us. Because they have that fourth set of cones, something else is added to the signal. So their perception of red might be very different from ours. And they may be able to see colors that we physically can't see. So quad chromatic eyesight is something that you might want to Google just for your own kicks and giggles. Okay. So that is one theory, the trichromatic theory. Where's my mouse here? Come down. Okay, the trichromatic theory is theory number one. The second theory is called opponent process. Opponent process. The opponent process theory is also known as the after image theory. And in the after image theory, this is how it works. Let's say that you have a constant red light coming in. You're staring at a white wall with a red dot, much like the flag of Japan, let's say. And you're not moving your head. And you're staring at this red dot on the wall. And you're not moving your head. You're looking right in the center. Well, that red light is painting a picture on the back of your retina. And because it's not moving off the back of your retina in that exact same spot, your brain is starting to habituate. We talked about habituation before. And so it gets really tired of looking at red. It's like a... It's like a 13-year-old daughter who doesn't like to go to family reunions. It just goes, ugh, do I have to keep sensing red? I don't want to sense red anymore. And so just like my daughter at a family reunion, she wants to do the opposite instead. So imagine this. The brain is receiving all of this signal for the color red, and it goes, ugh, enough already. So it also sends, or perceives rather, it also perceives a signal for the opposite of red, which is blue, right? Is it blue? I think it's blue. Maybe it's blue and orange. Maybe it's red and green. I don't know. Whatever the opposite is, it senses whatever the opposite is of that color. And when I look away from the red, I will have this weird glowing image of that same shape, but it'll be the opposite color. And you might have experienced something like this before. When you stare at something for a long time and then move away, you kind of have an outline of that thing, but it's in the reverse color of what it used to be. I have a video for this that we can watch, and we'll do that on the day that we do our Zoom lecture. We'll watch this video to demonstrate how this opponent process works. Okay? So that is our second theory on how we see color. The opponent process or after image theory. Let's talk about sound. Here is a very simple diagram. of the inside of the outside and inside of the ear. Let's talk about what happens with sound. Sound waves come in as waves. And this is actually a really important part of it. This is a test question that a lot of people get wrong. So we'll go through it very slowly. Sound waves come into the ear and are collected by this thing right here called the pinna. You don't need to know that, but it's called the pinna, P-I-N-N-A. And sound travels into the ear canal. And it hits a tight piece of skin we call the eardrum or tympanic membrane. Eardrum. It's connected to three very small bones. And I'm not going to write them down, so write them down. The anvil, the stirrup, and the hammer. The anvil, the stirrup, and the hammer are these three bones that are connected to the eardrum. When sound comes in, it vibrates the tympanic membrane, it vibrates the bones, and then it vibrates a plunger on this area here called the cochlea. And the cochlea is spelled C-O-C-H-L-E-A. The cochlea, I can tell that doesn't make any sense. C-O-C-H-L-E-A. The cochlea is the sensory structure that helps with transduction for us to get sound. Inside the cochlea, and this is just for your imagination, imagine that you have a sticky piece of duct tape running around the middle of it. And on that sticky duct tape are a bunch of hairs. Okay, I've got sticky duct tape running through the middle, a flat ribbon, and it's got hairs on both sides. Also inside the cochlea is a fluid. We'll just say it's water, but it's not. But it's a fluid. When sound vibrates this, vibrates this, vibrates the plunger, the liquid on the inside goes back and forth at the same frequency as the sound wave coming in. And these little hairs on the sticky duct tape wiggle back and forth. When they wiggle back and forth, they transduce that physical movement into a neural signal and then send it down the auditory nerve to the auditory cortex, the area of the brain responsible for hearing. So there's two different theories on how we hear sound. Let's say that you have a frequency that comes in, and because of the way that it's plunging, it really makes this area vibrate, but not so much over here or over here or over here. So this idea is called the place code. The place code. The place code says that certain areas on the cochlea are responsible for different frequencies of sound. That if this place is activated, the brain says that's a low or high signal. And this place over here is for something else. And this place over here is for something else. So all of these working together help us to understand sound. So that's the first theory, the place code. The second theory is called the temporal code. R-A-L. T-E-M-P-O-R-A-L. Temporal. Temporal is a word that you might hear, and temporal means timing. It's the timing that comes in. Let's say that there is a frequency that has no place. Because there are so many frequencies and the cochlea is only so big, it can't have a place for everyone. And so the rest of these frequencies have a timing code that goes along with them. We call the temporal code. So if there's a frequency coming in and all of the places say, that's not us, then everybody reads the signal and goes, this is what the timing is. This is how fast I am shaking back and forth. And everybody's shaking back and forth at the same, because none of them have the right place, but all of them are still shaking, and they're like, well, this isn't normally me, but this is what I'm sensing. That gets sent to the auditory cortex, and you perceive a frequency that has no place, but does have a timing code or a temporal code. So those are the two ways that we can sense sound. Now, what would happen if you were deaf? Most of the time, people are deaf because of what I call a mechanical problem. When you have mechanical deafness, that means one part of the mechanism is not there or not functioning properly. Maybe you were born without those three bones in the middle ear. What if you were born with no transduction hairs on your sticky duct tape? Well, sound is coming in and things are moving around in here, but because part of the mechanism or the machine is broken or not there, then no signal gets sent to the auditory cortex. The auditory cortex is just chilling. It's just going, hey, I've never heard sound before because no one has ever sent me a signal. Well, scientists have figured this part out. They have been able to come up with a device called a cochlear implant. Cochlear implant. What this does is it takes a microphone, which then records the sound, sends it to a transduction box, and that turns it into a neural signal, which is then pumped directly into the brain via an implant. Right. Scientists have figured out how to take regular sound, turn it into the exact same code that it needs to be within a margin of error, so that the brain, the auditory cortex, can actually understand what's going on. That's just crazy. So we can make deaf people hear as long as it's just a mechanical problem. Now, the other way to be deaf is much more rare, and that's an electrical problem. That means that the auditory cortex itself is either damaged or something is not right with it. That the mechanisms are working fine. Everything inside the ear, from the ear to the inner ear, is completely normal. But when that signal gets to the electrical recording area, the auditory cortex, for some reason it just doesn't work. But that's a lot more rare than a mechanical problem. The same really goes with blindness as well. Most people who are blind don't have an electrical problem, they have a mechanical problem. Something is either wrong with the eye, but typically not the cortex itself. Okay, let's move on to our next. Oh, here's something I'm seeing on my notes. How many of you hate the sound of your own voice? If you hate the sound of your own voice, raise your hand. Everybody's hand goes up. How many of you have actually apologized to other people when you have heard your voice in a recording? And you've actually said, oh my gosh, do I really sound like that? Oh my gosh, guys, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry that that's what I sound like. Now, here's where it gets a little crazy, because the sound that they are hearing is the only sound that you speak that they've ever heard. So you're apologizing for something that they don't know the difference of. Only you know the difference. So why? Why does my voice, when I'm speaking right now, sound differently than when I listen to my recording after I'm done to see if it's recorded well? Well, that's the biggest issue. Let's talk about what's going on. In order for me to hear my voice needs to be generated first. I press air out my throat, which vibrates my vocal cords, which then puts a frequency out my mouth. And I shoot out at 600 miles an hour my voice. My voice bounces off the surfaces in this room and then returns to my ear at almost the exact same time. It's very, very short between when it leaves and when it comes back in. And my brain perceives my voice just like everybody else does. So you would think that my voice should sound like what I really sound like, but it doesn't. And here's because I have an addition to my own voice when I speak. And here's how I can prove that. So first find your lower jaw, right? Now follow your lower jaw until you get to the top of it. And you know you're at the top, because when you open and close your jaw, you can feel the hinge. This is where the hinge between the skull and the lower jaw is. It's right about here. Now, if I have my fingers on both of these spots, and then I recite the first five letters of the alphabet like this, A, B, C, D, E, I will be able to sense a vibration in my fingers. Even though my mouth is over here, I can sense a vibration all the way back here. And that's because when my voice comes out of my mouth, it hits my teeth. It hits my teeth. And when it hits my teeth vibrate to the same frequency, which then travels down into the jawbone, which vibrates still, which then travels up the jawbone and vibrates still, and then vibrates the area all around it when it gets to the top, which just so happens to be right here next to the ear. So when I hear my own voice, I'm hearing my voice that bounces off all the walls, plus what I call mouth garbage. And that's a muddled frequency of my voice that comes in and gets added to the sound coming into the ear. So my true voice plus mouth garbage equals the sound of my voice that I hear. And the sound of my voice that I hear, no one else can hear. Only me. Crazy, huh? So I want to make an app. Here's my patent pending, haven't done any work, $1 million idea. I want to create an app that allows you to record your own voice and then tweak some of the scales so that it sounds exactly what you hear. And then you can play your voice to other people and say, do you hear that voice? That's what I hear when I talk. And everybody will be like, no, your voice does not sound like that. And you'll be like, yes, it does. I swear it does. It really, really does. So that's just an interesting thing with how or why. Why do we hate the sound of our own voice? It's because it's not really the whole voice coming in. It's voice plus mouth garbage. Okay. This segment also brought to you by... Brother Woolley's Can of Mountain Dew. Brother Woolley's Can of Mountain Dew. Keeping me alive ever since 1979. Yep. It's like, you've been an addict for that long? No. Okay, let's talk about our two chemical senses. We have two chemical senses. Let's talk about chemical senses. And these are smell and taste. Smell and taste are linked together. And the reason why we call them chemical senses is because these two senses take the physical properties of the universe and rip them apart into their chemical structure and then read those chemicals and send a signal to the brain, which then tells you that it's chocolate or strawberry or a roadkill that you're smelling, hopefully not tasting, but just smelling. So here's how they work. On your tongue, you have little caverns, little pits. And these little pits are like little traps, and they grab hold of bits of things and read them. So here's what happens. Food goes into your mouth. It hits your saliva. Your saliva is acidic. And it takes whatever it touches and starts ripping it apart right away and dissolves it. And that moist mixture goes onto your tongue. And when it falls into those little taste bud pits, a chemical receptor at the bottom goes, this is what I find. And it sends a signal up your tongue and into your brain, and you can sense that taste. There are five different tastes. They are three S's, a B, and a U. Okay, here's what they are. Sweet, salty, sour, bitter, and then a Japanese word called umami. It's not all capitalized. I just capitalized it all just for fun. Umami is the sense of savory taste. It's the taste of MSG And MSG is found in Doritos. Now, you might have heard, please avoid monosodium glutamate your whole life, or please avoid MSG because it's not good for you. But every single one of you that eats Doritos chips will find MSG. That's why we like Doritos chips. Umami. Not only do we have the cheddar flavor and a salty flavor, but we also have a meaty, savory flavor when we eat Doritos chips, and that's called umami. So, sweet, salty, sour, bitter, and umami are our five tastes. You will need to know those for the test. And that's how we sense taste, through a chemical structure called a taste bud inside the tongue. Now, when it comes to smell, smell works like this. This is one of your nostrils. When air comes in, all of the tiny little bits of whatever you are smelling come in as well. For instance, if you thought, like, you ever go past a drive past roadkill or just something that really smells bad? Well, the reason why it smells at all is because tiny, 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 tiny pieces of that thing are floating through the air as wind rips them off this thing. And anything that has a smell works just like this. Wind or air rips this thing off and sends it into the air, only for you to inhale it into your body. When you grab these little tiny bits of whatever, it attaches to the mucus or snot or boogers, whatever you want to call it, that are inside your nose. This is why when you have a very dry nose, you can't smell very well, because you have to have it to be liquid in there. You have to have some moisture in there. There are little hairs that come down at the top of the sinus and grab on with their sticky mucus, which then grabs onto these chemicals, rips them apart, and reads them. Now, the interesting part is that they travel from the sinus directly to the brain via this structure here called the olfactory bulb. O-L-F-A-C-T-O-R-Y. The olfactory bulb. The olfactory bulb actually goes through the skull. This is the bottom bone of your skull. So between your sinuses and your olfactory bulb is your skull, and this thing reaches right through it. The olfactory bulb wears the brain like a hat. The brain sits right here. That's the brain. I can't even read that. But that's the brain. So you smell things quicker than any other sense that you have. Another thing is, you've never miss-smelled something, typically. You don't smell strawberries and go, whoa, is that, and you know, you're never going to miss-smell something. Also, it hits you really, really fast because of the extremely short distance that these neurons have to send a signal through the sinus to the olfactory bulb and then to the brain. We're talking like it only has to go that far. For me to have something sensed by my touch, it has to go from my fingertip all the way through my arm to my central nervous system, to my spinal cord, and up to my brain, and then it's perceived. But for smell, it only has to go that far, barely any distance at all. That's why smells hit you so hard when they're strong, because it's such an overload to the brain. Okay, so what happens when these tiny little particles go down into the lungs because you breathe them in? And then on their way out, they hit themselves on the back of your tongue, which is also where your air travels. Past the back of your tongue. Well, if a smell has enough concentration that these particles are kind of overloading here, and so a lot of them continue down, and then as they come back up, they're deposited on the back of your tongue, you may have the sensation of taste for this as well. And some of you may have used the phrase, "It smells so bad, I can taste it." That's because you are tasting it. you are receiving not only a signal from your nose, but from your tongue as well, as those little bits of gross attach themselves and are read by the taste buds in the back of your throat. Okay? So another thing, we talked about these being linked. If you block smell, you also shut off taste. And if you don't believe me, try it. Take something that has flavor, like chocolate, and plug your nose. And then put the chocolate in your mouth and start to chew for 10 seconds. And then get an idea of how it tastes. And then undo your nose. And you will instantly have a rush of flavor to your brain. Because these are connected. One doesn't work without the other. Genetically, there are people who are on the low end of the spectrum when it comes to smell and taste. These people are poor tasters and they're also poor smellers. If you're like me and you have to put hot sauce on nearly everything just to get something out of your food, that means that you're like me, you're a low smeller with a low taster. But if you're like my wife, who is a super taster and a super smeller, she can taste the slightest hint of anything. And sometimes too much of something overpowers her senses and she goes, I can't eat that because it's too flavorful. Children have such brand new bodies that they have a much better sense of taste and smell, than do adults. This is why children tend to like bland foods like chicken nuggets, French fries, and ketchup is like their biggest condiment. They're like, ketchup, right? It's not like me who needs zesty sauce at Burger King just to go, oh, do these fries have any flavor at all? So kids are better at sensing taste and smell than adults. And some people are super tasters and other people are poor tasters. And then everything in the middle. Okay. Let's move on to our last sense. Our last sense is the sense of touch. Now, we talked about touch before. We talked about how there are three types of sensory cells. There's sensory cells for... Oh, I just realized. We forgot something. Why isn't spicy a flavor? Why isn't spicy a flavor? That's because spicy is not a flavor at all. It's a pain response. See, the chemical that causes spicy sensation is called capsaicin. And capsaicin is something that burns you. With enough capsaicin, I can spray it in your face, and that's what pepper spray is. It's a high concentration of capsaicin that goes into your eyes, and it burns. So capsaicin sets off your pain response in your tongue. It also sets off the temperature response in your tongue. This is why when you eat hot foods that are not temperature hot, but spicy hot, your body still reacts as though the temperature of your body is increasing because your brain is receiving a signal that, ouch, this hurts, and wow, it's really warm in here. So you may start to sweat when you have spicy food. Now, if you're like me, the sensation of spicy doesn't hit as hard as someone like my wife. My wife can't do spicy at all. And I can participate in hot sauce eating contests and still get to the end and not be dead. So that's why spicy is not a flavor, because it's a pain response. It's a false temperature and pain response that your body is receiving. Okay, now moving on. Touch. I have pain, pressure, and temperature receptors in my skin, in different concentrations in the body. So really what I want to work on are the two other senses that go along with touch in the body, and that is the kinesthetic. I see. Kinesthetic. K-I-N-E-S-T-H-E-T-I-C. The kinesthetic sense is your body awareness sense. For instance, if I'm sitting here and I close my eyes, I cannot see where my hands and feet are. But if I do this, part of my body tells me that my hand is raised. I know where it is in relation to the world around me because only of my kinesthetic sense. If I put it higher or lower, or if I do two hands together, or if I grip them together, now I guess I have touch, but if I just keep them apart, I can tell where my hands are. I look like a TikTok dance here. Okay, so if I do TikTok dance with my eyes closed, it's my kinesthetic sense that tells me where my arms and legs are in relation to the world around me. If I have a very good kinesthetic sense, then I can balance very well. I can do sports. I'm a natural at sports because I know where my hand and eye coordination are just going to work. They're just better than most people. But on the other end of the spectrum, just like with taste or smell, you have people who have very poor kinesthetic sense. And these are the people who trip over their own feet or are walking on a flat sidewalk and stumble or are walking around a corner and they jam their shoulder into the wall. It's because they don't fully grasp the idea of where their body is in time and space in relation to the world around it. So your kinesthetic sense what am I trying to say here? It's knowing where your body is in relation to the world around it. Knowing where your body is in relation to the world around it. Now, here's how you can test a very simple exercise on your kinesthetic sense. So you need two arms and two fingers for this one. So first of all, take your fingers and point them forward. Point your wrists down and point your fingertips forward. Then you're going to extend your arms out like this so that the fingers on both arms, I can't do both, are pointing straight forward toward your front. And then you're going to close your eyes. And after you close your eyes, in one motion, you're going to try to put your fingertip to fingertip just like that. Okay, let's see if I can do it. If I extend my arms and I close my eyes, see, I missed. So if I do this a few times in a row, in my mind, I can sense where my body is and I can get closer and closer until I get it. And not only do I get it, I start to get muscle memory for it. So I can hit it nearly every time now. But if I find myself doing this and I go like that, and I can never seem to find where my hands will come together, I may have poor kinesthetic sense. Now, I've always been good at balancing, so that's why I don't have a problem with kinesthetic sense. So that's our first sense. The second touch sense that we have is called, and this is the last thing we do on sensation, vestibular sense. Oh, that's much easier to read. Vestibular sense. This is your sense of balance. Balance. So how do I know whether I'm falling or not? Well, that's because of my vestibular sense. Next to the inner ear, next to the inner ear, you have some semi-circular canals. You have these semicircular canals, and these have fluid in them. And as you move your head around, the water, let's just say it's water, the water in the canal sloshes back and forth through this canal. Inside the canal, there are sensory locators, which when the water hits them, say, this way is down. And if I turn, now this way is down. And if I turn my head really far, now this way is down. Now see, down is always the same way, but my body needs something to be able to sense that down is always this way. What happens if I get drunk? Have you ever seen a video of someone who gets drunk and then falls over? Well, that's because the fluid or the water inside the semicircular canal becomes thinner and it sloshes back and forth much, much easier than it should. So when someone is drunk, and they're they lean a little bit forward, that water scoots way higher than it's supposed to and gives the person a false sense of down. When you have a false sense of down, you don't know which way is up. And so your body overcompensates. And this is why drunk people, once they get tipped, tend to just stay getting tipped until they fall over, because they can't sense the true down and up. So don't get drunk. It doesn't help you. Okay? So the reason why we have the vestibular system is our sense of balance, and also it's caused by fluid running in the semicircular canals. Now, the last thing that we talk about in the vestibular system is your ability to get dizzy or motion sickness. When I spin, if I were to spin in this chair, the fluid would also be spinning. But if my body stops, the fluid is still spinning. That's going to cause my brain to go, whoa, what's happening here? And the reason why that's happening is because I am getting two different signals. My eyes are saying, you have stopped. You are not moving. But my vestibular system is saying, yes, you are. So now my brain is getting two different signals. My signals are getting crossed. And this is why people tend to get motion sickness. If I'm driving in the backseat of a car and I'm looking at my phone, my eyes are telling me, you are not moving, because I'm looking at my phone and my phone travels where I go. But if I'm on a bumpy road, my vestibular system is telling me, yes, you are moving. So one sense is saying yes, the other is saying no. And when those both hit the brain, your brain, some people's brains, can't figure those two out. People who have a really difficult time having these two signals come together at once get motion sickness easily. But there are some of you out there who have never been motion sickness or never been motion sick at all. And the reason is that your brain understands the different signals coming in and can reconcile and say, I got this. I'm okay. So that's what's going on here with motion sickness. You're having two different senses. Your vestibular system is saying yes, and your eyes are saying no. Two different senses sending two different signals to the brain cause motion sickness. Okay? All right. Why don't you, if you haven't by now, go ahead and pause for a few minutes. Stand up, stretch, do your thing. We are going to get into the rules of perception. These are not nearly as long. We're already in 1 hour. We have a very short amount left still. Again, brought to you by Brother Willie's Can of Mountain Dew. Brother Willie's Can of Mountain Dew. Just that lemony goodness that you always need in your life. Okay, so welcome back. And if you haven't, pause it, and then come back. Go ahead and stretch. We've been here for an hour. I've been sitting here talking for an hour straight, and I'm just going to keep moving on. Let's talk about perception. We are going to watch some videos on our Zoom day together. So really what I want to do is, let's see, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9... I have 11 different terms that I want to talk about, and then we're done, and then we'll just watch videos Thursday or Friday, whichever day is your day. There are rules. There are rules on how you perceive. And what we're going to talk about now is a lot having to do with the perception of sight. The reason why we have a lot of rules for the perception of sight is because that's the one that we tend to rely on most. Without the ability to see, we tend to slow down. We tend to pay more attention to our hearing and to our touch. But with our eyes open, we tend to just go at full speed, even faster than full speed, at any time that we want to. Sight is really important for us to be active. So there are rules. The first three rules are called perceptual constancies. Constancy. The perceptual constancies. That's what we have here. The perceptual constancies. These are three different constant things that describe objects. So I'm going to use, I'm going to use a different object because I actually have to do something to it. Let's look at this. I know. Let's look at this book on turtles. Turtles, everyone. Reptiles that live in the water. Okay. Our first perceptual constancy is size. Now I'm going to use the camera to help describe what's going on here. This book looks smaller because it's away from the camera. But if I do this to it, now it's taking up your whole screen. Now, the question is, did the book get bigger? Did the size of this book get bigger? Well, of course not. What happened was it got closer. So here's the definition for this rule for size. We perceive, you can write this down, we perceive the size of an object to be the same despite or regardless of its distance. So size is relative to the distance of the object. We perceive the size to be the same regardless of its distance. This book is not getting bigger, it's just getting closer, right? Closer and further away. What about the shape of this book? I have some magic. I can make this book change shape. Ready? 3, 2, 1, boom! All of a sudden, the book is much tinier. Now watch this. Magic, boom! Ah, I've changed the shape of it again. Now, you say, what do you mean you've changed the shape? Well, think about it. What part of the book is hitting the back of your eye? When I do this, a lot of the book is hitting the back of your eye. When I do this, a lot less of the book is hitting your eye. And if I change this, it's still a different shape than it was before. In fact, if I were to take this book and do this, the object on your screen is constantly changing its shape on the back of your eye. But do you believe that this is a shape-shifting book? No. Your perception is the orientation is different. So the shape of an object stays constant or the same despite its orientation. So orientation changes, but not the shape of a book or the shape of any object. When you see someone from behind, you don't think that they are a different person. You just think, I'm seeing a different perspective of that person. And then the last thing is color. And color has to do with the brightness, the observable brightness on this object. This object is green, let's just say. But if I were to dim the lights very much in this room, let's try it. Let's dim the lights for a second. Okay, get an idea. This is what it looks like. And then if I turn off the lights in this room and I bring it back, it's not exactly the same shade of green. And the more dark I make it in here, the more dark the green looks. But did the object change its color? No. So the color of an object remains constant despite the brightness. So we have the size of an object stays the same relative to distance. The shape of an object stays the same relative to its orientation. And the color of an object stays the same in relation to the brightness in the room. These are the three perceptual constancies. And it's because of these that you gained a sense of what was around you. Okay, where's my thing here? We are going to mess with your mind. In fact, here's some things to look forward to. If you've made it this far, congratulations. And if you've made it this far today, you're going to know that in the next couple days, I am going to make you hallucinate in your own living room or wherever you're watching. You are going to hallucinate in your house when we go through this chapter on tomorrow and the next day. We're actually going to do some pretty cool stuff. Okay? So, those are three of the rules. Those are the perceptual constancies. The next set of rules that we talk about are called the gestalt T. Gestalt, G-E-S-T-A-L-T. Gestalt principles of grouping. The gestalt principles of grouping. The gestalt P of G. And I'm going to erase that now. The gestalt principles of grouping. This is how we take a lot of information that we see and make sense of it. For instance, let me give you the first rule. What is... wait. wait a second, guys. Wait a second. Okay, what is that? You're right, it's an arrow. But what if I said it was a tree instead? You see, the first rule is simplicity. Oh, ran out of room. Simplicity, I'm gonna write that better. Simplicity. Simplicity says that the simplest explanation is what something is. That when I see something, the simplest explanation is the first thing I go to. That's why it's difficult for me to go, what is that? If you don't know what something is, you don't have a simplest explanation. So you tend to be confused by things you're not familiar with. So simplicity says that the simplest explanation is true, even if it's not true. Okay? Here is our next one. What shape is this? What shape is this? You might say oval or circle, and you would be wrong. Why? Because a circle is one line with no corners or edges, and an oval is the same thing, just kind of stretched. This is just a series of lines that you, in your head, closed. You did this. You closed all of these empty gaps. This is the rule called closure. Closure. Okay? Closure says that when given enough information, my brain will create the rest of it in order to finish it. So I finish objects that are not fully there. Closure is another important thing that our brain does because it has to have it. Here's proof. I can make most of you sing a song. And it goes like this. Oh, say, can you see by the... See what I did there? You're still singing the Star Spangled Banner. Because you have to. Because you need closure. And the funny thing is that in 5 minutes, some of you are still going to have that looping in your head. Now, the best thing to do if you ever get a song stuck in your head is to listen to the entire thing. Because if you've ever had a song stuck in your head, it's never the whole song. It's just like 8 measures of the song on repeat. And it's really bad when I get 8 measures of Cardi B running around in my head, and then I have to listen to a Cardi B song in order to get rid of the Cardi B song that's in my head. So that's what closure is all about. You have to have answers to questions. You can't get broken up with and not know why. You can't have a game that you don't understand the rules of. You can't have a question that goes unanswered. We love closure. So that's rule number two. Okay. If I were to say, describe for me what you see, you would probably tell me that you see columns of X's and O. You see two columns of X's and one column of O's. Very few of you would say you have three rows of XOX. Because the simplest explanation is that similar things go together. These must be a group. These must be a group, and these must be a group. This is the rule called similarity. Oh my gosh. Oh, I'm running out. I'm running out of chunk. Similarity. Similarity just says that objects that are similar in size and shape must somehow be related. Think of a football team, a football game. You know who's on what team because one team is similar in their color and the other team is similar in their color. And that's how I can tell the two apart, because of their similarity. Okay? So similarity just says that if things look the same or nearly the same, they must be somehow related. Oh, gosh. All right, here's something else. Does the first thing you see, column of X, O's, and X's? No. Or do you see rows of X, O, X? Probably not. Or do you see four distinct groups of XOX? One here, one here, one here, and one here. That's because things that are close together seem to be related. This rule is called proximity. Oh my gosh, I'm running out of chalk. Gotta figure something out. Proximity. Proximity just means that if things are close together, we perceive them as being somehow related. Think about it. If you see a young man and a young woman walking together from one campus building to another, but they're not holding hands, but they're 18 inches apart and they're walking at the same pace. It doesn't matter whether you know them or not, because they are close together and walking together, we perceive them as somehow being related. Maybe they're a couple, maybe they're siblings, but something puts them together. Which is really fun when we don't have to practice social distancing. Because one of the things that I tell people on campus to do is find a stranger, put some earbuds in, and walk from behind them and be 2 feet away from them and walk the exact same speed. And don't talk to them at all. And one of three predictable things will happen. The other person will speed up, or the other person will slow down. And in that case, so do you, right? They may stop to tie their shoe. In that case, you stop to tie your shoe. And then the third predictable thing that might happen is they will force the connection between you by saying, "What? What is it? Can I help you with something?" Where you take out an earbud and go, "Sorry, what?" Which is just really fun. As long as you're not hurting people, feel free to have fun with breaking proximity rules. So proximity just says when things are close together, they must somehow be related. Ooh. Our final two are... new chalk. Oh my gosh, gotta get new chalk. Can't believe I used it all. Chalk, 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 chalk. Rule number five. All right, so what are the two line segments that we have here? Most of you will say AD and CB, and you're not wrong, but we have more than that. We also have AB, we have AC, we have CD, and we have BD. These are all of the line segments. But the thing is, the simplest explanation is AD and CB because of a rule we call continuity. Continuity says that as I am moving in one area, if I come to some form of juncture, the thing, as long as the edges are aligned, they must be continuous. Easiest way of saying that, when I come to an intersection in my car, do I perceive the road in front of me to be the same road, or do I believe that the one crossing is the same road I've been on? Continuity says that if I'm moving in this direction, I should keep moving in this direction. That's continuity. So continuity just says that if, I'm trying to remember the technical word that I use on the test. Something about edges being aligned, and I'll look it up. We'll talk about it on the exam review. Lines and edges are aligned. If they're aligned, then we perceive them as being the same thing. I perceive C road to be the one that takes me to B because of continuity. And same with A to D. That wasn't explained very well. We'll get it later. Okay. And then our last rule is called common fate. Common fate. And this has to do with groups of objects moving together. If you've all seen that highway sign that tells you to change lanes and merge because this lane is ending, what you'll see are a group of lights that will illuminate. First, these will come on. And then, this set of lights will come on. And then, this set of lights will come on. So they'll go bing, 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 and we perceive this group of five lights moving, even though they're not really moving. But because they're a group and they stay together, that's called common fate. Common fate says a group of objects that moves together must still be related. A group of objects that moves together must still be related. And there is a very specific form of common fate that you use on a regular basis, and that's with your cell phone. If you have your cell phone, go ahead and pull it out and swipe left and right on the screen. Swipe left and right on the screen. You will have this idea that the screen is moving, right? But is it moving? No, it's not moving. What you're having is lights on the screen illuminate in sequence, and that gives you an apparent motion. Apparent motion. I think it's A, it might be E, or it might be E here. Apparent motion. Not actual motion, but apparent motion. The apparent motion is when something seems to be moving, but it's not really moving. Like, if you had a snake just slithering, but it not actually moving, but just doing this, it's moving, but it's not really moving. So the apparent motion of light has its own term we call the phi, P-H-I, the phi phenomenon. The phi phenomenon. I'm going to do it up here. The phi phenomenon. Phenomenon. The phi phenomenon is the apparent motion of light. It's what any screen does. It gives you the sense of moving. Like when you watch my arm move on your screen, your screen's not actually moving. It's just that the light on your screen is changing color to give you the apparent motion of light, also known as the Phi phenomenon. This is a special form of common fate made specifically for light. Okay? Last thing, then we're done. Actually, I'm going to save that one. I just realized. That's all we have for chapter 3. Next week, we'll do the exam review and begin chapter 4. And we will also be ready to take exam number 1 next week. So when I meet with you later on, we're going to talk about this one last thing that I wanted to talk about. But I need to have the video along with it. I hope you enjoyed this. Again, this was brought to you by Brother Willie's Can of Mountain Dew. Brother Willie's Can of Mountain Dew, still cold 80 minutes later. We'll see you next time.